Never had a cramp any time during any of my very long days. TheraWorks Relief has made my workday muscle cramp free. Period. End of sentence.
TheraWorks Relief is my choice for preventing and relieving muscle cramps. Make it yours too.
Get TheraWorks Relief today in stores everywhere.
I'm Brianna Keeler, live from CNN's Washington headquarters. Underway right now, the Senate slaps Michael Cohen with a subpoena before he goes behind bars. Moments from now, the Senate will vote on two bills to end the shutdown. But spoiler alert, it won't end the shutdown as millions of Americans continue to suffer. And the dysfunction is accompanied by warnings growing about the real-world impact of the shutdown, like the risk to your safety if you're flying. Plus, suck it up, Buttercup. That is the latest tone-deaf message to federal workers forced to quit their jobs, sleep in cars, and ration or forgo their insulin. The president's daughter-in-law calls it, quote, a little bit of pain for the future of our country. But up first, the Senate Intelligence Committee now trying to force President Trump's former attorney, Michael Cohen, to testify before he heads to prison. The committee has subpoenaed Cohen and they want to question him next month. Just yesterday, Cohen said through his lawyer that he was postponing his testimony before the House Oversight Committee, citing threats to his family from President Trump and Trump's lawyer, Rudy Giuliani. I've got former DOJ prosecutor Joseph Marino with us, as well as CNN political correspondent Sarah Murray. So it sounds like Michael Cohen is actually going to testify, but this testimony would be behind closed doors?
I mean, he may be forced to. And look, the Senate Intelligence Committee has done all of their work behind closed doors. We know that it's been much more of a bipartisan investigation, certainly much less of a circus than from what we've seen in the House when Republicans were leading it. And, you know, we'll see what happens now that Democrats have control. But I think, you know, the other thing that would be different about this is it was pretty clear when he was going to go and speak publicly before the House Oversight Committee, he was going to share personal anecdotes. There were huge parts, of this investigation he couldn't talk about, essentially everything that was under investigation. I have to imagine that the Senate Intelligence Committee would want to hear something very different from Cohen behind closed doors, why he lied, of course, but they would want to know things that are pertinent actually to the Russia investigation they're conducting.
And this is the very committee he lied to. We know that, right, in his from court documents as well. Joe, what do you think of this, that he's been subpoenaed?
Well, I think ultimately, I mean, Sarah's right. He doesn't have much of a choice. He can say that he feels threatened. He can say he'd rather not appear, but ultimately he will appear. And the Senate can make certain arrangements in terms of making it behind closed doors so it's not public, it's redacted if and when it does get released in part. But at the end of the day, he's gonna have to answer questions. He's not gonna be able to hide behind any kind of arguments that he feels threatened, and ultimately they're gonna get what they want. And I think that it was criticized. The Republicans were criticized at the midterms for basically slow walking their oversight. And I figure even though the Republicans still control the Senate, might as well, they control the process now rather than let the Democrats in the House run with this and then do whatever they will do.
You also have reporting about Roger Stone, Sarah. Tell us what's going on.
Well, I've been looking at Roger Stone for a while now, and we're sort of waiting to see what happens with him. And it's kind of a piece about what it's been like to be Roger Stone, to be essentially under investigation for years on end. He believes he's been under surveillance since 2016. And, there's this constant threat that he's about to be indicted, but his team has never heard anything from Mueller. For a while, Roger Stone wasn't even making plans on Fridays, one of his friends said, because he was so worried that could be the day, the FBI comes for him. And when I talked to him, he was telling me that this has been a financially debilitating experience. He's gotten a little bit more creative with his fundraising. He's now selling Roger Stones. He's actual signed stones. He's selling T-shirts. Mm. And he's employed a social media strategy involving his dogs. Take a listen.
Roger Stone did nothing wrong. Roger Stone did nothing wrong.
These are
is that
the
his various, voice? Whose voice is that?
I don't know exactly whose voice it is. He says this was a collaborative effort with his family and some editing software to try to keep people interested, raise money for his legal defense fund. He refuses to say how much money is in that fund. But, it's a very interesting case to be Roger Stone going through all of this. He's seen so many of his associates hauled in before Mueller, hauled in before the grand jury. A lot of those people he doesn't even talk to anymore.
He hasn't been hauled in, which is key, Joe. What is ahead for Roger Stone? What do the tea leaves say?
Well, it seems like from the beginning of this that he seems to occupy such a critical role because he may or may not have some understanding of the connection between the Trump campaign and the release of certain emails that were hacked. And so it's been a big question since the beginning of what did he know, was he involved, and who else knew about it. So we've been waiting to see what will happen with Roger Stone. Interesting strategy. While most people will kind of just keep a low profile, Roger Stone has taken the opposite tact with all these antics on television, in the media. So when he ultimately has his day, it'll be really interesting to see how it goes down.
No one has accused him of being undramatic, we should say. Ever. Sarah, Joe, thank you, both of you. Competing plans, both expected to fail. The Senate voting next hour on two proposals to end the government shutdown, now in its 34th day. The plan passed by House Democrats reopens the government through February 8th and provides $12 billion in disaster relief. The proposal by President Trump and Senate Republicans includes $5.7 billion for his border wall. It also includes some asylum law changes that advocates say are really, really bad for asylum seekers. Also more than $12 billion in disaster aid and all seven appropriations bills that Congress has not passed. CNN senior congressional correspondent Manu Raju is on Capitol Hill for us. So how's this expected to play out?
Well, we expect both of these proposals to go down. We do expect some Republicans to vote for this Democratic plan that includes Lisa Murkowski of Alaska, Susan Collins of Maine, Cory Gardner of Colorado, who's up for re-election in 2020, along with Collins. They're expected to vote for that plan to keep the government open, reopen the government up until early February. But other than a handful of Republicans, we're not expecting mass defections, which means it's going to fall short of the 60 votes needed to advance. And on the plan to implement the president's proposal, also expected to fail. At least one Democratic senator said he would vote for it. That's Joe Manchin of West Virginia. But others said Democratic senators are not saying that. One senator to watch, Kristen Sinema, the newly elected Arizona senator, I just asked her if she would vote for the Trump plan. She would not say. Now, but that's still going to fall short of 60 votes, which is needed to advance. Now, the question is, what next, Brianna? How do they get out of this stalemate? I'm told that there's a group of a bipartisan group of senators who are trying to discuss any sort of plan to cut an immigration deal and reopen the government. They plan to continue to meet, although they are nowhere near a deal. They plan to talk and take to the Senate floor, call on their colleagues to cut a deal later today. Again, they need to find a way forward. They don't have one yet. And on the House side, Democrats are coming up with their own ideas to come up with $5 billion to meet the president's demand for border security. But they told me today they're not going to include funding for the wall.
Is there any way you fund the wall in this plan?
We fund border security.
But what about the wall?
At this point, there's no money for a wall. There will probably be money in the overall to look at fixing some of the existing wall.
Do you think there's any chance that the Democrats will offer the president any money for his wall after the disaster?
No, never. We will not negotiate during a government shutdown. We cannot allow a negotiating tactic of a shutdown to ever give the president any advantage, because he'll just shut down the government again and again.
And that's the view of the House Democrats, that never give money for the border wall until the government reopens. Then they can talk about it going forward. Of course, Brianna, that is not what the White House wants to hear. So unclear what happens after these votes go down this afternoon. Brianna.
Manu Raju on the Hill, thank you. Tomorrow, federal workers will receive their second paycheck with $0, not really a paycheck. That means they can't pay bills, groceries, mortgages, car notes, vital medicines. Those realities are not resonating with many members of President Trump's inner circles. In fact, some of their comments seem really tone deaf.
A huge share of government workers were going to take vacation days, say between Christmas and New Year's. And then we have a shutdown, and so they can't go to work, and so then they have the vacation, but they don't have to use their vacation days. And then they come back, and then they get their back pay, then they're, in some sense, they're better off.
It is a little bit of pain, but it's going to be for the future of our country, and their children and their grandchildren and generations after them will thank them for their sacrifice right now.
Mr. Secretary, there are reports that there are some federal workers who are going to homeless shelters to get food.
Well, I know they are, and I don't really quite understand why. There's no real reason why they shouldn't be able to get a loan against it.
All right. Well, they'll tell you they aren't. CNN political commentator S.E. Cupp and CNN political analyst Ryan Lizza, I want to get your take on this. What did you think about Lara Trump talking about the hardship that federal workers and contractors are going through as a little bit of pain, Essie?
Well, in the sort of playbook of crisis comms responses, all the other options probably would have been better, right? If you're a multimillionaire daughter-in-law of the president who doesn't need to work, one option is to not do press, is to not do television during a time that's painful for a lot of people. Another option is to go out and be honest and say, I cannot relate to the pain that a lot of people are feeling. I've been really fortunate, but I have compassion, I have sympathy. The other thing to do would be to say, you know, very cannily, I understand the pain that's out there, and that's why Democrats need to come to the table. To do none of those and to sort of shrug off the pain is probably worse than doing nothing, worse than saying nothing. It seems like a real unforced error. I'm not really sure it's one the administration cares that much about, because they keep putting people on TV to sort of drum that defense that it's not all that bad. So this might be exactly what they're looking for, but I think you're seeing the results of that in those poll numbers that have not been good for the president.
And Wilbur Ross, Ryan, saying he doesn't really understand because people should be able to get loans. Yeah, that's not how it works
You're a billionaire. I'm sure it's not too hard for Wilbur Ross to get a loan. I mean, we've had previous shutdowns before, right? And so administrations have had to talk about this. But what we've never had is our government officials, elected officials, saying this is great for them, right? Usually there's at least some acknowledgement that this is painful, right? That this is, nobody wants this to happen, but there are policy implications and that's why this had to happen. I mean, to use the sort of cliche of the moment, it's like taking the hostages and then arguing that it's really better for the hostage once they're released. They'll really thank us later, and they're being treated really well. It's beyond tone deaf. I mean, go ahead, Essie.
I didn't mean to interrupt you, Ryan. I just wanted to say, the other week I had South Dakota Governor Kristi Noem on my show, and I asked her about the very real effects of the shutdown in South Dakota, a state that went for Trump, that is one of the hardest hit. And she said very interestingly, look, I have farmers who are hurt by the shutdown, but they care more about getting their border wall. Now, I don't know if that's spin, I don't know if that's true, but there might be some idea, amongst the administration that calling this a sacrifice, that people will be sort of willing to take on the chin, might have some resonance somewhere. Again, I don't know if that's true in reality and practicality, but they seem to be, a number of them seem to be going with this theory so much that it seems almost premeditated.
No, it's a good point. I want to talk about something else. The latest look inside Cliff Sims' book. He's a former White House aide. It's called Team of Vipers. So Vanity Fair got their hands on this latest excerpt in which Kellyanne Conway orders Sims to, quote, use that, meaning her computer, and type something up for me, sort of a PR response. And iMessages start popping up on the screen. She is bashing by name Jared Kushner, Reince Priebus, Steve Bannon, Sean Spicer. And though Sims says she's not trashing per se, more painting in, quote, unfavorable light, the president himself. Kellyanne Conway, White House leaker, SE, what do you think about this description?
Well, you have to look back at Kellyanne's resilience in this White House. There is a reason she has survived longer than any aide almost not named Trump in this administration. It's because she's been canny. I think she's probably been very crafty. She's the first woman to win a presidential campaign. That doesn't just happen by accident. So to reveal that Kellyanne Conway has been maybe playing both sides, the media and Trump, the media and the White House, none of that surprises me. What I think will be interesting to see is whether Trump himself is bothered by just how cunning she and canny she's been to stick around as long as she has.
Well, she's in the White House, Cliff isn't, so she's
right.
Got a chance to talk to Trump about this and trash him. Look, I just want to make a defense of leakers in the White House. There's nothing, I know Cliff calling her a leaker, it sounds pejorative, right? But there's nothing wrong with Kellyanne Conway talking to reporters. In fact, we need White House officials to talk to us.
Yeah.
I The hypocrisy sometimes comes, of course, when she goes out there and attacks other people talking to the press, attacks other leakers, right? But, you know, one person's leaker is another person's important source.
Mm-hmm.
Yes, very, very good point. Ryan Lizza, SE Cup, stand by for me. Now, the Trump administration being called authoritative as more and more cabinet officials refuse to testify before Congress. Plus, some TSA officers hitting their breaking point during the shutdown. They're quitting their jobs at least one airport. Plus, a dire new warning about the safety of airline passengers. Why air traffic controllers and pilots say flights and security are at serious risk. House Majority Leader Steny Hoyer blasted the White House today. He is fuming over this decision by not one, but two cabinet secretaries just to not testify before House committees, even though they've been requested to. He said, quote, "It's what I expect from people who think they are authoritarian leaders of our government, and it starts with the President of the United States." I want to bring back Ryan Lizza to talk about this. Treasury Secretary Steve Mnuchin, he's refusing to testify before Congress about the impact of the shutdown. And Alex Azar, the HHS Secretary, is refusing to testify about the impact of the administration's practice of separating families at the border. Why are they treating these requests from Congress as just suggestions?
I mean, it's wild. I mean, this is just another way in which the Trump administration is defying, you know, the basic norms of how the government works. I mean, if there's one thing Congress needs to do, it's oversight. A lot of Democrats in the House believe that they won back the House because the public wanted more of a check on the Trump administration. And so, you know, now we're going to have this dance where their requests come in, officials in the executive branch deny them, and we'll see if they can step up the pressure to force them to testify. We have seen this in previous administrations. Remember, Eric Holder was held in contempt of Congress for not going before them. But at the end of the day, there's not a huge, you know, it's not like they're going to go to prison or something, right? There's not a huge consequence. It's just public pressure that can force them.
And let's talk. You have a little news on Michael Cohen. He is.
Yeah.
Okay. So he said, "I'm not actually going to testify." Through his lawyer, he said, "I'm not going to testify before the House Oversight Committee," citing fears of Donald Trump and his lawyer Rudy Giuliani.
Yeah.
But then the Senate Intel Committee, which is the committee we know he lied to, for sure, they subpoenaed him. And so they are going to talk to him, presumably behind closed doors.
That will be behind closed doors, is my understanding.
But
yes.
You just talked to Lanny Davis, his lawyer. What did he tell you?
He says that they are expecting to be subpoenaed by one or more House committees. So likely
on the House side.
On the House side, Democrats, intelligence, and oversight. Now, Elijah Cummings, it was disappointed that Michael Cohen pulled out of the testimony, and so they are very likely to subpoena him, and you know, sooner rather than later. And once that happens,
public hearing.
That's right. So Intel could be behind doors, mm-hmm. but oversight would definitely be in public. That would be the presumption. And if he's subpoenaed, now there'll be a back and forth, right? I don't think Michael Cohen is going to simply not respond to the subpoena.
Yeah.
So I think it is likely we are still going to see him testify mm-hmm. in public. But they're going to want to negotiate the parameters of the testimony, and they're going to want to, for instance, make some issues off limits, right? So I think we're still going to see him testify. He's been working on his public testimony for a long time, right? This is his moment, right? This is a moment to rehabilitate himself. This is his moment to show some contrition in the public, all before he goes to prison. For lying to Congress and directing those payments. So I don't think it's off, you know, despite the fact that he pulled out of his publicly scheduled testimony, I think we're still going to see him.
Wow. All right. Ryan Lizza, thank you. Very interesting. And a dire new warning from unions who represent air traffic controllers, pilots, and flight attendants as this shutdown drags on. How safe is it to fly? And Senator Joni Ernst publicly confronting painful memories of rape and abuse, publicized in her divorce papers.
I'm still the same person as I was a week ago. The only difference is that you know more about me now.
Unions representing aviation workers are issuing a dire warning that air safety is, quote, deteriorating by the day as a result of the government shutdown. Sources tell our affiliate in Hawaii that some TSA officers have started turning in their resignations. It's not clear exactly how many, but the TSA says absentee rates are double what they were a year ago. The head of the Air Traffic Controllers Association says the stress is taking its toll.
The fatigue in my work environment right now, where I'm seeing routine mistakes are actually happening because they're thinking about which credit cards can I consolidate up for zero interest? Who's giving you a break on your phone bill? Or which company is helping you out so you could skip your mortgage? These conversations are happening in the work environment because the stress is getting very high.
Michael Huerta is the former FAA administrator. Sir, thanks for being with us and lending your authority to this conversation.
Thank you. It's my pleasure.
You heard there the head of the Air Traffic Controllers Union saying that routine mistakes are happening. What kinds of things would you worry might slip through the cracks?
Well, there is no one at the FAA that is going to intentionally do anything that is not safe. But like Paul, I am concerned about fatigue and concerned about distraction. You know, you think about it, being an air traffic controller is one of the toughest jobs we have in our country. It requires a high degree of technical training, and controllers are being asked to forego paychecks. They've lost one. They will forego another one in the next few days. And it's ridiculous. They find themselves in a situation where they have to drive for Uber. They perhaps have to wait on tables during their time off. That is wrong. What a controller should be using its time off, his or her time off for, is to rest so that they can ensure that when they come to work, they are fully alert and prepared to keep the system safe.
In the Washington, I'm glad you brought that up about some of them driving for Uber and waiting tables. That is a headline out just a short time ago from the Washington Post. So we're talking about air traffic controllers responsible for the safety of airplanes, spending 10 hours on a shift, and then on their time after that, they do something where they can make money. So that means they're not sleeping.
Well, again, no one is going to intentionally put the system in danger. But aviation safety is the ultimate team sport. It is one of those professions where everyone works together to ensure that the system is safe for the users. You know, think about it. On any given day, there are about 2.5 million people that get on airplanes in this country. And we have an unbelievable safety record. The people who are getting on airplanes are thinking about a lot of things. They're worried perhaps about the weather wherever they're going. But we have had the luxury of not worrying about whether it's safe. And that's because the professionals at the FAA, the airlines, the airports, the manufacturers, everyone is working together to ensure that the system can be safe. Now we have this incredibly difficult challenge where a very important group of people, the air traffic controllers, the aviation safety inspectors, the technicians, all the professional support staff, are wondering where their next paycheck is going to come from. Yes, many of them are working, but they have to cover the fact that they have not been paid. And to me, it makes no sense that a safety agency like the FAA, that the professionals who work there would be held hostage over a matter that they have nothing to do with. Our country deserves better.
Just real quick before I let you go, because I hear what you're saying about the big concern, and you're taking a very big picture look here. You seem to be using restraint when it comes to raising concerns about the specific things that could fall through the cracks. Is that on purpose? Are you trying to raise concerns without trying to scare people about some of the specifics about what happens when air traffic controllers maybe aren't getting enough sleep or are stressed out by these things?
Well, safety is many layered. We always have, you know, we have training, we have all the professionals are trained to look out for each other. And so what you want to ensure is that by having many layers of safety, that things don't fall through the cracks. If you deteriorate, if you're taking actions that are going to deteriorate any one of those layers, mm-hmm. you are introducing risk into the system. And fundamentally, safety is all about managing risk. What we need to be doing is putting mitigations in place so that we're strengthening those layers, not weakening them. And, you know, again, we have many, many people that are participating and looking out for one another. What we don't need is to be introducing stress into that system that is degrading the risk management policies that we have in place.
All right, Michael Huerta, we really appreciate you talking to us, former FAA administrator.
Thank you.
So coming up, the crisis unfolding in Venezuela. The U.S. is refusing demands from the embattled president, Nicolas Maduro, telling American diplomats to stay put despite his orders. And as the president digs in on his border wall, CNN goes deep underground to see how drug smugglers are getting creative.
Products.
Venezuela is a country in political chaos with an international community that is taking sides and U.S. diplomats who are caught in the middle. Right now, there are two declared leaders. You have Venezuelan President Nicolas Maduro and self-proclaimed President Juan Guaido, which is why there's a challenge here, because you have President Trump, along with leaders from Canada, the EU, many Latin American governments, throwing their support behind Guaido, not all Latin American governments, we should say. Maduro, though, is still backed by the military and key countries like Russia, Turkey, China, Mexico. Former U.S. Ambassador to the U.N. Bill Richardson has served as an election observer in Venezuela. He has met Maduro many times. In fact, he just saw him a few weeks ago, and he is joining us now. First off, you saw him a few weeks ago in Mexico. Tell us about that.
I did. This was the inauguration of the new Mexican president, Manuel López Obrador. And I had known Maduro when I dealt on hostage issues with President Chavez. Maduro was a foreign minister. You know, we had a very brief interchange, Maduro and I, because I know him. But he looked a little nervous because he'd not been greeted by the Mexican public very well in the Mexican legislature. He'd been booed enormously, and he only attended this kind of VIP luncheon. So I could tell he was nervous.
Mexico backs him, which is clear, but clearly a lot of Mexicans do not. When you look at the diplomats who Maduro is saying, you're not welcome here. You have, what, at this point, 2 days to leave the country, because he said 72 hours a day ago. And the president is saying, you know, you're going to stay put. What does that mean for the U.S. diplomats in Venezuela?
Well, it's risky for our diplomats. However, we have a lot of security at the embassy. I don't think Maduro would mess with our diplomats. But I think it was a bold move by the administration, by the OAS, by several Latin American countries, a majority, to say, we're not recognizing Maduro anymore. We're recognizing Guaido, even though Guaido is basically doesn't have much power. He has a little bit of military support, but enormous popular support. So I think what we need to do, the international community, is push for the military to say, let there be a free and fair election. I think that should be the diplomacy following the hardline sanctions and efforts of a number of Latin American countries to basically isolate Maduro. Because Maduro has been, you know, he's divided the opposition. He's been skillful in keeping his power. But now, you know, this is a crucial point with this new young leader, because the opposition had been very divided. 35-year-old guy who's captured the imagination of the Venezuelans, but also, you know, there's massive inflation, there's a lot of corruption, the food prices are out of control. So maybe this is going to be a sign to Maduro that he's got to compromise.
You worked with OAS certifying Maduro's first election. Right. That's important to note that you were in Venezuela for that. How do you think that this leadership struggle is going to play out?
Well, in the end, it's going to be up to three players. One is the Cubans. The Cubans help Maduro with security, with political support. They have to recognize that there has to be a change. The second is Mexico. Mexico is supporting, the government of López Obrador is supporting Maduro, while most Latin American countries are not. And then third, Brianna, is the military in Venezuela. They're key. I mean, they're the biggest power center. So far, Maduro has most of their support, but that is eroding. But I think the diplomacy should be get the Venezuelan military to insist that there should be free and fair elections, internationally supervised. You know, Maduro will probably run, but Guaido will run. And I think the reformist candidate will win. But the opposition in Venezuela has been divided, and now it seems to be unified with this young man that we've recognized. So it was a pretty bold move to do what we're doing.
So many of your different roles intersect the important news of the day. So while I have you here as the former governor of New Mexico, a border state, I want to ask you about, we're in the shutdown, right? We're in day 34. Second paycheck about to be missed. The president recently adopted a new slogan, which is build the wall and the crime will fall. Our own Ed Lavandera actually reported from a tunnel at the border, and the sheriff that he spoke with there does not quite agree with the president.
This wall is actually the international border line, and this black patch that you see is actually an old tunnel that was used by smugglers. And Mexican authorities have sealed it off, but this is what it looks like underground here.
I think we have the world's record as far as tunnels are concerned, over 100, maybe 110, 120 drug tunnels. The more difficult you make it for them, the more creative they're going to be.
Right. That's a lot of tunnels.
That is a lot of tunnels, and at some point you wonder if it's got going to be a huge sinkhole on this side of the border.
First off, crime has not been rising because of this, we should point out. But there you see the challenge against a wall. What is your reaction to all of this?
Well, look, Brianna, I was a border governor. I dealt with border issues. There has not been an increase in illegal immigration through borders. It's through tunnels. It's through ports of entry. It's through the ocean, the Coast Guard. It's not through having a wall is overly expensive. It's not going to work. People will climb over the wall. They'll go under as the tunnel shows. I think the president and the Congress need to come to an agreement that more what is needed is more border security. I'm for that. More detection equipment, more border patrol agents, more overflights. But a wall is symbolic to the president's political base. But I think now with day 33, so many travel TSA employees, my state is being hurt a lot, businesses, federal workers there. We're a state dependent on federal workers. So is the whole country. You know, I am flying out of here. I don't know if I'm going to get out with some of the TSA employees. They're not getting their paychecks. These are honorable people that shouldn't be treated this way.
Ambassador, thank you so much for being with us. Bill Richardson, former ambassador to the UN. We appreciate you being here. And just moments from now, the Senate is going to vote on two bills that are going to fail. These are live pictures of the Senate floor ahead of these votes. Plus, House Speaker Nancy Pelosi playing hardball, and she wins. Why did President Trump concede so quickly over the State of the Union address?
Anderson Cooper, 360. Tonight at 8 Eastern on CNN.
This just into CNN, the White House is considering whether to invite congressional leaders to meet with President Trump on the government shutdown as early as tomorrow. And it would be the first such meeting that we've seen in 2 weeks now. President Trump walked out of the last meeting in the White House Situation Room. We have Ohio Congressman Tim Ryan, a Democrat on the Appropriations Committee, with us now. Thanks for being with us, sir.
Thank you. Thanks for having me.
So this comes after this battle between the president and Speaker Nancy Pelosi over the State of the Union address. She had encouraged him to change the date. He said, actually, I'm going to come up to the Hill. And she had said, basically, no, you're disinvited. He tweeted, this is her prerogative. I will do the address when the shutdown is over. What did you think about how this back and forth ended?
Well, that may have been the most mature thing the president said in a long time. I think he got a real lesson in the separation of powers. He got a real lesson in Article I. The people govern in this country. Article I created the Congress of the United States, the House of Representatives. And we invite the executive branch here to address the State of the Union. He's not a king. He's a president. And he needs to be held accountable to the people, which is represented in the Congress. So I think he got a real lesson in that. I'm glad that's behind us. I hope they get together tomorrow. We have got to figure this out. People are really suffering out there.
There are 30 House Dems, led by freshman Congresswoman Elaine Luria of Virginia. They're asking for consideration of money for a barrier, obviously to be separate from reopening the government, but they are asking that there be consideration of this as an assurance, maybe to bring Republicans, to bring President Trump along. When you look at that, do you consider that as some cracks in the caucus? Because it does seem that there is some of the Democrats are feeling the pressure that there needs to be movement here.
Well, I think it's more of a signal that, and I include myself in this, that a lot of Democrats are for border security. We are for making sure we know who's coming in. And if there needs to be barriers in certain places, of course, we would want to do that. But the vast majority of what we need to do is technology. Walls are about the past. Walls aren't about the future. And so I think they're signaling that we want a comprehensive plan, of which may include, I actually think, you know, one of the ways out of this is to put a commission together, four people appointed by the president, four people appointed by the Speaker of the House, big names, you know, maybe Bob Gates, maybe Condoleezza Rice, John Kerry. Let them sit down and tell us what is the best way for us to secure the United States of America. Border, ports, ports of entry, and then come to us where we have an up or down vote on their recommendations. I think that's a way where the president can say, look, we're going to let the experts decide. Maybe there'll be some barriers, maybe not. The Democrats can say, look, maybe there's going to be some barriers. We're obviously going to utilize a lot of the technology that we're pushing and give us that recommendation, but kind of get it out of this political quagmire we're in now.
You, ahead of this Congress, were pushing for an infusion of fresh blood, certainly into mm-hmm. leadership. And there's been a lot of freshmen who are taking a stance when it comes to this issue. The latest move, this letter, was initiated by a freshman. Is that what you had in mind when you were talking about fresh blood?
Yeah, I don't mind that at all. Everyone has a voting card. Everybody has a district to represent. And I think throwing these ideas out there are really important to let the leadership know where we are, and I hope they sit down tomorrow, because I think we're getting kind of close. I think that the president backing away from the State of the Union issue, I think, signaled that he wants to start being a little bit more serious and kind of move away from the drama. And I think these stories are starting to hit home, like I'm hearing in Youngstown, Ohio, where, you know, federal workers are starting to, you know, get kicked out of their apartments that they're renting. I mean, this is getting really, really hard for these families. And we just saw the stat the other day, 40% of families in the United States have less than $400 in a bank account. And many of them are federal workers that can't make these payments. So kicking these ideas out, speaking your mind as a freshman, I think is altogether appropriate.
All right, Congressman Tim Ryan, thank you so much for being with us.
Thanks.
Ahead, Senator Joni Ernst publicly revealing memories of rape and abuse in a new emotional interview.